I was raised in a criminal environment. My dad was always in and out of jail.
Like father, like son.
My dad gave me the green light to do it.
And he didn't disappoint.
I took pride in the fact that everything I did was illegal.
His life of crime.
This doesn't count all the aliases I've been arrested under. This doesn't count my juvenile record.
And how he beat the rap.
He'd say, Irene, I don't want to live like this anymore.
On today's 700 Club.
Welcome to the 700 Club. I'm Christy Watts. Well, in parts of the Midwest, it's being called the worst flood in recorded history. And people in some areas are desperately praying that the rain will stop. In fact, the floods have been devastating for so many homes. And some residents are saying that they've just never seen anything like it. Heather Sells has a story.
Already, flooding in the Midwest has killed at least three people in Indiana and Missouri after raging water swept away their cars. In Peoria, Illinois, the Illinois River has crested at a record level, 29.3 feet, and flooded downtown businesses. Along the Mississippi, massive problems. More than 100 barges broke free in St. Louis, colliding with a bridge. Across the region, residents are in disbelief.
I've lived here all my life, and I've never, ever seen anything like this.
We come downtown to walk a lot, at least a couple times every week, and never seen anything like this.
In Comstock Park, Michigan, the high cresting waters devastated Bruce Lane's neighborhood, and then a second tragedy. His home was looted.
Everything in this home is destroyed. This fella just took everything out.
In Des Plaines, Illinois, outside of Chicago, homeowners are still cleaning up.
Came in like a waterfall. We were bailing and urging it down the drain pipe until the window burst. The basement window burst from the water and people parading outside.
In other communities, the race is on to fill sandbags and fortify in advance of rising waters.
There's so much work to be done and there's not enough people to do it.
For farmers, the rains have already delayed corn planting and could reduce the amount they'll plant this year.
Even as some of the rivers are showing signs of cresting, the recovery isn't expected to come quickly or easily. The National Weather Service says many waterways in the Midwest will remain high on into next month. Heather Sells, CBN News.
Wow.
Yeah, you know, you look at those stories, Pat, and it seems like there's always something, isn't it?
Well, I tell you, this country's being just overwhelmed with bad weather, and it's just this the beginning.
Yeah.
So I guess from now we start going into hurricanes and tornadoes, but my goodness. Mm. So anyhow, pray for those folks in the Midwest and that flooding, the worst on recorded history. Well, there may be another possible tie between those suspects in the Boston bombing and I don't know whether we call it a religion or the philosophy or the system of Islam. Lee Webb has that story from the CBN newsroom. Lee.
That's right, Patty. Radical Muslim may have had a strong influence on the older of the two brothers. Officials say the friend steered Tamerlan Tsarnaev toward a strict form of Islam. His family says Tamerlan gave up boxing and stopped studying music after meeting the man known only as Misha. Tamerlan also began opposing the Iraq and Afghanistan wars and turned to jihadist websites under Misha's influence. Investigators say Tamerlan may have encouraged his younger brother to follow suit, but the mother disputes that story. She claims her sons are innocent and Misha was just a friend. Police, though, are interrogating Johar Tsarnaev, the younger of the two brothers, in his hospital room. He's been upgraded from serious to fair condition. Well, the Boston attack shows how small homemade weapons can wreak havoc on a community and an entire nation. And it's prompting authorities and the public to be more aware. Mark Martin has that story.
An abandoned school bus in a remote location in Virginia.
Fire it all! 3, 2, 1.
Less than 10 pounds of homemade explosives and the bus is no more. It's a demonstration of the power of bombs that can be made anywhere with items found right under your kitchen sink. Watch it one more time. A chilling sight, especially when you consider, what if this was a terrorist attack?
One of the goals of detonating the bus is to show the harsh reality of homemade explosives, to make authorities aware that a lot of damage can be done with only a small amount of bomb-making materials.
They are used more commonly all the time, and it's just a matter, unfortunately, of when as opposed to if. So rather be prepared than have to catch up, and that's what we're trying to do, is keep people on the forefront of what's going on.
Mike Doherty works for American Canine Interdiction. The organization primarily trains dogs to detect bombs, but in this case, they're teaming up with Tripwire Operations Group to teach people, first responders, law enforcement, and bomb squads to be on the lookout for homemade explosives.
I hope all our students, when they go back to the respective jurisdictions, that we have enabled them to be able to identify homemade explosive formulations. If they were to go to serve a search warrant or stop a car and it's full of all these precursor chemicals, they're able to put it, the two and two together, to say these people are posing a threat of some kind.
According to the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms, and Explosives, between 1998 and 2008, approximately 4,200 incidents involved the possession, manufacture, and use of homemade explosives for experimentation and criminal purposes. The ATF reports 5 were terrorist bombings, and the rest involved people experimenting and motivated by curiosity.
We want to be ahead of the curve to protect our neighbors and those that are in our communities around us.
In 1995, the Oklahoma City bombers crafted a 5,000-pound bomb on American soil, a bomb that destroyed 1/3 of the Alfred P. Murrah Federal Building, created the 30-foot-wide, 8-foot-deep crater, and took the lives of 168 people. That's why experts say it's urgent for public servants and those they serve to take the issue of homemade explosives seriously, to be educated on what to look for, and to call authorities immediately if they suspect a bomb of any size is being made, or worse, on the verge of detonating. Mark Martin, CBN News, Smithfield, Virginia.
Wow. Pat, you can't help but think there's going to be a big demand now for those bomb-sniffing dogs to get them trained and out in the field for
Absolutely.
Events like that.
They are very valuable, and they've got olfactory sensibilities that are just thousands of times more sensitive than human. And, oh, my goodness, just a little bit of fertilizer and a few other ingredients you can get at a local hardware store, and suddenly you have made a bomb. And then it's extraordinary. We have so-called soft targets in America. You know, Eric Stackelbeck did a study of the jihadists next door and what they can do. It doesn't take much, and innocent-seeming chemicals can be used to wreak havoc. And when you think of the awful carnage and the people losing their limbs, it's not just the fact that they were killed, which is horrible in itself, but the limbs, legs were cut off, and people will be permanently maimed because of this. This is very serious and very terrible. So, well, we live in a time of terror. But I say it before and I'll say it again. They say none dare call it terror. Let's name it what it is. It is Islamic motivated terror. It is set up to terrorize a population, to interrupt their commerce, to interrupt their normal way of life, and to make them afraid. And believe me, it won't take many bombs to accomplish that purpose here in this great land. Lee.
Pat, the judge in the trial of a Philadelphia abortionist has thrown out 3 of the 8 murder charges against the doctor. Prosecutors charged Dr. Kermit Gosnell in the death of a 41-year-old patient and 7 babies reportedly born alive. They told jurors Gosnell and his staff killed the babies by cutting their spines. Gosnell's attorney, though, argues there is no scientific or objective evidence that they were born alive. The judge dismissed 3 of the baby's murder charges with no explanation. Gosnell could still face the death penalty, though, if convicted on the 4 remaining counts of first-degree murder. Former employees have already been convicted and have testified against Gosnell. President Obama will deliver the keynote address Thursday at Planned Parenthood's annual fundraising gala. Cecile Richards, president of the nation's largest abortion provider, praised him, saying, President Obama has done more than any president in history for women's health and rights. In his re-election campaign last year, the president promised to fight Republican efforts to cut Planned Parenthood's funding. Pat?
You know, aren't you horrified at this? The president of the United States is going to give the keynote address at a fundraiser for an organization. Now, get this. They perform between 300,000 and 350,000 abortions a year. 300,000 babies are slaughtered by Planned Parenthood. Planned Parenthood now receives in excess of $500 million of taxpayer money. And the American Center for Law and Justice, of which I happen to be the chairman, has lawsuits. One just concluded with the settlement. I will not have liberty to speak of the numbers, but it was substantial in Texas against one of their small branches. The big lawsuit is in California, where so-called whistleblowers have come forward to say this organization is triple billing the United States government. And as what I understand, the U.S. Justice Department is coming on the side of the American Center for Law and Justice in that lawsuit. And here the president is going to try to raise money for those people who are now being accused of defrauding the federal government. How about that for politics, Lee?
The U.S. Army is removing Bible verses etched in the scopes of their weapons. The verses are from the Gospel of John and 2 Corinthians, to name a few. The manufacturer Trijicon inscribed them on the sights. Soldiers at Fort Wainwright in Alaska tell Fox News they were ordered to turn in the scopes so the verses could be scraped off and covered with black paint. An Army spokesman says Trijicon has agreed to remove scripture from future orders of those scopes. The IRS will be giving furlough notices to all of its employees for at least 5 days before Labor Day. The tax agency says the move is necessary because of the spending cuts forced by the sequester. That's when Congress and the White House failed to reach a budget deal earlier this year. On the furlough days, all IRS public services will be closed. Those include toll-free phone help and taxpayer assistance centers. Other federal agencies are also furloughing employees, and critics say the move is just a publicity stunt to make the budget cuts look more painful than they really are, Pat.
There's no question about it. The defenders of big government will go to any length to force the issue upon the American people to say, you've got to have big government, you have to spend more money, you have to run big deficits, because if you don't, we will shut off your tours to the White House. Or your friendly IRS agent won't be there to collect your taxes. And that, of course, is reason enough not to sequester. Lee?
Yes, we haven't heard the last of that either from the federal government, Pat. Meanwhile, House Republicans say former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton bears responsibility for last September's attack on the U.S. consulate in Benghazi, Libya. Four people, including Ambassador Chris Stevens, died in the attack. An interim report faults Clinton and other senior State Department officials for approving cuts in security at the Benghazi facility. The report said senior State Department officials knew that the threat environment in Benghazi was high and that the Benghazi compound was vulnerable and unable to withstand an attack. The report is also highly critical of President Obama and White House staff, accusing them of changing accurate talking points drafted by the U.S. intelligence community in order to protect the State Department. Well, Christians and Jews came together this week to stand with Israel. A night to honor Israel was held last night in Virginia Beach at the Rock Church International, and Pat was a special guest. He told how he made a vow to God that he would stand with Israel no matter what.
We're here because we love Israel. Why do we love the Jewish people? Well, you know, I serve a Jew. His name is Jesus. He's the Messiah of Israel. My life is ordered by a book called the Bible, and all the books of the Bible, with the possible exception of one, were written by Jews. We have a Jewish religion that we adhere to. And therefore, we feel that the Jews are our brothers and sisters. We are one in the family of God.
The largest pro-Israel organization in the U.S., Christians United for Israel, sponsored last night's event. Pat?
That was fun. I really get jived up speaking in defense of Israel and in support of Israel. I love the Jewish people, and I love Israel, and I think it's been reciprocated. They know that I'm one of their strong friends and supporters, and every chance I get, I'm going to Boston in another few weeks to speak at another similar gathering, and I think it's important that we make a stand. Israel is being surrounded by enemies, and when I see some of the propaganda aimed against Israel, it just makes me sick because it's so much of it is false. But these people are amazing, and the Bible says they are the chosen people of God. So, Christy, it was fun last night. I missed you. How come you weren't there?
I was home asleep. But I was supporting you in spirit.
You're supporting me in spirit. I heard those snores coming up through. Right.
Absolutely. Well, up next, new gun laws in Colorado have law enforcement officials up in arms.
A sheriff, I was elected to set the priorities for my agency, and that's not it. Turning law-abiding citizens into criminals is not my priority.
Find out what the new laws are and why these lawmen are refusing to enforce them after this.
Connie and I love having cell phones because of the freedom they give us. So why would we want to be tied down to a contract?
Life's too short.
And Consumer Cellular gives us control over how and when we use them and what we pay.
And compared to our old plan, we're saving a ton of money every month.
So what really sold us on Consumer Cellular was that they're the exclusive wireless provider for AARP members.
AARP? That's a huge deal.
Was it complicated to switch?
Not a bit. They make it super simple. You can even keep your number.
Oh, that's nice.
Consumer Cellular, affordable service without the contracts. Try Consumer Cellular risk-free for 30 days with free activation, a $35 value, and free shipping. Or just pick it up at a Sears store. Plans start as low as $10 a month.
Call Consumer Cellular at 1-800-393-4301. Go to ConsumerCellularTV.com or visit a Sears store today.
Thursday. Old habits are hard to break, but it doesn't have to be that way.
Everything we know about the science of habits indicates that any habit can be changed.
We'll show you how to break or make a habit once and for all. Plus, on the ice with Coyotes captain Shane Doan.
God made me full of passion and intensity. I love that part of the sport.
Thursday on the 700 Club.
Millions of people in America are out of work. The numbers of people on food stamps is shocking. Millions and millions of people taking food stamps. Chaos in the mortgage market. People are confused as to what to do about North Korea and Iran nuclear attacks. What does our president do? He wants to keep you from having guns. As if that should be the most important issue. But last December, gun control became the hottest issue in the country after those shootings at Sandy Hook. The call went out to tougher gun laws in states across America. But critics argue that these new laws won't prevent gun violence. And I totally agree, they won't. Charlene Israel has that story from ground zero in that debate. The state of Colorado.
Tough new gun laws are popping up across the nation. In New York, certain firearms have been reclassified as assault weapons, and those who own them must start registering them. The law also limits the number of bullets in magazines to 7. Connecticut added more than 100 assault weapons to its list of banned firearms. As for ammunition, magazines are restricted to 10 rounds. Citizens can keep larger capacity magazines in their homes and use them at the shooting range. Owners of those magazines or the now banned weapons have until January 1st to register them. On the national level, Senate Democrats failed in their bid to pass new gun control measures. The bipartisan proposal would have created tighter background checks, ban assault weapons, and ban large capacity magazines.
This effort is not over.
President Obama says his administration will now take steps on its own without Congress. Possibly the biggest surprise happened out west in Colorado, where ammo magazines will be limited to 15 and expanded background checks begin July 1st. The move comes nearly a year after that deadly mass shooting at an Aurora movie theater. New gun restrictions here in Colorado have sparked intense debate, even among law enforcement officials. Some claim the new rules violate the Constitution, and they're refusing to enforce them.
You know, as sheriff, I was elected to set the priorities for my agency, and that's not it. Turning law-abiding citizens into criminals is not my priority.
Weld County Sheriff John Cook joins more than half of the state's 62 sheriffs, challenging the new laws in court. He believes the laws would make it harder for people who want guns for legal purposes to get them. About a dozen sheriffs spoke against the new laws during President Obama's recent visit to the state, a trip he made to push his administration's gun proposals.
We're filing it in federal court under the Second and 14th Amendment that if you outlaw magazines, you're outlawing the gun, basically. And the Supreme Court has already said you can't outlaw the guns. And so we feel it's an infringement on our rights as law enforcement officers and for the citizens that we protect. So we do believe that it's unconstitutional.
Sheriff Cook also argues the new rules give a false sense of security.
They're trying to make everybody feel good. These are feel-good, knee-jerk reaction laws. And politicians, what they do is they say, oh, well, we had a tragedy, so we need to do something. I think they give the people that are naive a false sense of security, like, oh, now we're safer, when actually we're not.
You have your Colorado driver's license?
Mel Bernstein runs the Dragon Arms Gun Shop in Colorado Springs. Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold once visited the gun store before killing 13 in the Columbine school shooting.
The kids were here 30 days before they shot up the school. They wanted to buy an MP5 and an M60 machine gun.
Anyone wanting to purchase a long gun in Colorado must be 18 and 21 to buy a handgun. Because Harris and Klebo were both underage at the time, an 18-year-old female friend of the pair was going to purchase the weapons for them. The M60 is a fully automatic machine gun and requires a 90-day waiting period. Because the boys wanted the weapons sooner, they declined to purchase from Bernstein. There is no waiting period for shotguns, semi-automatic rifles, or handguns. The girl ultimately purchased a rifle for them elsewhere, something considered an illegal straw purchase. Bernstein says stricter gun laws won't stop criminals from getting guns illegally.
No matter what laws they make, the criminals are always going to get a gun. There's millions and millions of guns out there.
Sheriff Cook points to the case of the Colorado prison official gunned down at his home last month.
The murderer had a long criminal history. I mean, was in prison for many years. A woman bought that gun to give to him. So he didn't go in to get the background check. He had a friend do it who could pass one.
Coloradans are mixed on the issue.
I think there's some really good measures that they're trying to attempt to put in place, but with the widespread use and ownership of guns across America, I'm not sure that the current measures go far enough.
I'm not sure that it makes a big difference, because you can really, I'm a physician, you can really do a lot of damage with 15 bullets. Being a physician, I'm a fan of mental health.
And these are the ones that are in support of my stance.
Meanwhile, Sheriff Cook isn't backing down.
My philosophy has always been an armed society is a polite society. So we don't need to make it more restrictive. We need to loosen up the laws, because we already have thousands of laws on the books with gun control. And so this is the wrong direction.
Charlene Israel, CBN News, Colorado Springs, Colorado.
Thanks, Charlene. We understand, or I understand, I heard a commentator saying that in every single instance of gun violence, the strange things that happen where young people shoot up a theater or what have you, those individuals are in some way on psychotropic drugs. They have been prescribed primarily by physicians. And these drugs cause psychoses of various magnitude. And they're given indiscriminately because it's just too much trouble to treat the underlying causes of these people's problem. And so a pill pusher will just say, well, take three or four of these with a glass of water every day and hope you get better. Well, they might get better or they might get delusional, and a number of them get delusional. And then they can get a gun. There are plenty of guns, 300 million guns in circulation. These laws are meaningless. And as the sheriff said, it's a feel-good measure that politicians think, well, I'll just show the population I'm doing something. Nonsense. What ought to be done is to begin to regulate the dispensing of these powerful psychological drugs. That is the source of our problem. Christy.
Interesting, Pat. Well, coming up, a couple who had the money to do what they wanted, when they wanted, until the economy crashed.
It was a feeling of just drowning, just absolutely drowning. And a lot of anger going around, a lot of sadness for Kurt because he felt like a failure.
But see how a miracle helped pay their mortgage and save their marriage. But first, we're gonna bring it on with your email questions. Tash wants to know, what exactly is grace-based teaching? And how do we know when messages of God's grace are being exploited or used to deceive us? Interesting question. Well, we're gonna tackle that when we come back.
The simple truth is that today's investment world can be very confusing. In the short run, real assets like gold can go down and paper assets can go up. But not for long. So along with learning the truth about the dollar and inflation, my grandpa also is teaching me the four W's of wise gold investing. Why?
Gold is a store of value, a wealth preserver in a world that's flooded with debt.
What?
Gold coins are true money that can never be devalued.
When?
If you don't own any gold yet, Breda, you better buy it immediately.
Where?
Swiss America offers fair prices, great service, and higher education.
It's all explained in this simple truth newsletter, CD, and DVD. And best of all, it's free! Call or log on now for your free Simple Truth Kit. Learn the basics about the 21st century gold rush for safety and growth. Next time, I'll explain the simple truth about a golden retirement.
He promised healthcare for everyone. But now, seniors are getting hit with more than $700 billion in Medicare cuts. Insurance costs are going up. Businesses say they can't afford Obamacare, so they'll pay big fines and millions of employees could lose their health care. Plus, everyone pays hidden taxes and fees, as much as 40% on some health plans. But you can get the truth. Get the brand new book, The Obamacare Survival Guide. It's number one on Amazon and a New York Times bestseller. Inside, you'll discover hundreds of loopholes, tips, and strategies to survive Obamacare now. Join the more than a quarter of a million people who've claimed their copy and get yours before it's too late. Go to Obamacare911.com. The Obamacare Survival Guide will give you hundreds of tips on how to save money and protect yourself. You can pick up your copy in bookstores for only $19.95 or have your copy rushed to your door for the internet-only price of just $4.95. Go to Obamacare911.com to claim your copy now.
Kids, we want them to grow up knowing God's Word. But in today's busy world, sometimes we could use some help. The free Superbook Kids Bible app has fun stuff your kids will love. They'll have a blast learning the Bible, playing great games, watching cool videos, discovering heroes in the Bible. They'll have fun while they learn God's Word. The free Superbook Kids Bible app, available on the iTunes App Store.
Well, I have some exciting news. So, all right, pull your chair closer. You ready? All right. CBN Superbook is up for a Webby Award. You're like, okay, Christy, what's a Webby Award? All right, here's the deal. The Webby Award is the leading international award honoring excellence on the internet, including websites, interactive advertising, and online film and video. Now, this is where we need you. You can actually help support Superbook win by going to cbn.com/webby. That's W-E-B-B-Y. why. And also be sure to let your friends and your family know about this so that they can vote too, because the more votes, the greater the chance that we can win. So please, whatever you do, hurry up, because the voting ends tomorrow.
Oh, my goodness.
I know. And don't forget to go to cbn.com/Webby to vote for Superbook
Webby.
To win a Webby Award. Are you going to vote, Pat?
I don't even understand what you're talking about. I'm in that other generation.
Says the man who has never touched a computer for 80-some-odd years, and what was it, a year or two ago was the first time?
I got an iPad. And I just touch all those little screens.
There you go. All right. Well, we're going to have some more fun. It's time for email, where we're going to bring on your email questions. And I don't know, I put them somewhere, so I'm going to read them up here. Tash starts us off and says, "Dear Pat, could you please clarify what exactly is grace-based teaching and why is it so prominent today? I mean, to what extent are we subject to the laws of Moses? And does God still punish us as he did in the Old Testament? And for what reasons? How do we know when messages of God's grace are being exploited or used to deceive us?"
That is a very lengthy, complex question. Grace is God's unmerited favor. Grace. By grace are you saved through faith. It is the unmerited favor of God to us. And so what has been done by some people, the Apostle Paul in his day said, there are those who are teaching, let's sin boldly that grace may abound. And you know what the Apostle Paul said about those people? He said, their condemnation is just. In other words, they should go to hell for that. That's basically what the Apostle Paul was saying. Because what he's saying is, you're going to take advantage of God's grace and think, I'm forgiven of everything, and therefore I could do anything I want to do. That is a misuse of God's favor. God is favoring us because we serve him. And Jesus said there are people who are going to come to him and said, you were teaching in our streets. You were there in our midst. And he's going to say, depart from me, you cursed. I never knew you, because the ones who will have my favor are those who do the will of my Father in heaven. So he also said, not one, you know, the jots or tittles or the little marks, the vowel marks in the Hebrew letters. And he said, until all is fulfilled, not one jot or tittle is going to go from the law. So he didn't come to abolish the law. He came to fulfill the law. So don't get your grace teaching messed up. We are still under the moral law of God, and we want to serve him with our hearts in love. And the love is the commandment that we're under. Okay.
Okay. Sounds like a lot, but it was really good.
Did you get that?
I got it.
Good. You got it. All right.
All right. Casey writes in and says, I've been wanting to live a more Christian life, but I'm struggling to do so. My husband wants nothing to do with a Christian life, and he struggles with drug issues and a little bit of anger as well. Well, on top of this, we have two children together. How do I steer my children and myself in the right direction to live a Christian life when I'm living with, when I guess the person who she's living with is completely opposite? Also, my husband and I both struggle with cigarettes. Please, I need some advice. Help.
Well, the advice is you shouldn't have married that guy in the first place, but you did, and so now you're stuck. So let's talk about what to do with it. You have got to make a decision in your mind that you're going to live for Jesus. Regardless of what your husband does or doesn't do, you're going to live for Jesus. And if you have small children, you're going to take those children with you to church. You're going to teach them the Bible. You're going to pray together. You're going to have family prayers. You're going to say grace over the food. And whether your husband likes it or not, that's too bad. Now, in terms of the cigarettes, you're going to have to say, no, I used to smoke a pack and a half a day, so I'm not talking from theory, I'm talking from knowledge. There came a time that I said, I'm not going to get lung cancer, I am not going to do it, and I'm going to kick the habit. It takes 21 days to form a habit, which means that today I don't smoke, the next day, today I won't smoke, the next day, today I won't smoke, the next day, today, for 21 days. And after a while, it reverses. And in my case, it reversed to the point where I couldn't stand the smell of cigarettes. I couldn't stand cigarette butts. I couldn't stand smoke around me. Instead of it being desirable, it was repulsive. Now, that's what can happen. But you have to be strong for those 21 days. And the same thing in your life. You must decide you're going to follow Jesus. And then you're going to begin to study the Word, learn the Word, and get together with those who love Him. And even if it's a small group, a little Bible study group, or whatever, you're going to meet with people who love the Lord. And you've got to determine to do it. Don't blame your husband, and don't blame the fact that he, you know, is a druggie or whatever. You married him, but nevertheless, perhaps through your godly lever, you can change him.
Well, you know, it's interesting. Can I just jump in and say one little thing? The last thing that you said, well, the whole thing was great, but the last thing that you said was so important, because as women, sometimes we have the tendency, you know, we might be following God, the spouse might not be, mm-hmm. and so we want to change that spouse. One of the best things that we can possibly do is do exactly what you said, where you honor the Lord, you love the Lord, you do right before the Lord, and your example might influence the husband. Then you just put him in the hands of the Lord and say, Lord, he's your child. You can do something with this heart. So there you go. All right. Patricia says, Pat, what are penny stocks? Ooh, I don't know. And in your opinion, are they a good investment? Good question.
Well, I mean, it's a huge group. Penny stocks are stocks that sell for pennies. They sell for 25 cents, 30 cents, 50 cents, 10 cents, 8 cents. Yeah. They're cheapos. There's some really good penny stocks. And if they move, they move in a hurry. It doesn't take much to get a stock to go from 10 cents to 20 cents, but you've doubled your money. But they are usually pretty risky. They're not well financed, and they're out doing speculative things. They haven't necessarily built up a track record, nor are they building up earnings. So like any other stock, you've got to study the potential. But many of the really excellent mining stocks and energy stocks are starting out as penny stocks, and then they grow. Study them. You just can't say the whole bunch of them. Some of them are frauds, some of them are go bankrupt, and some of them are going to make a fortune. So, you know, study them.
Cool.
All right.
Next question's from Nicholas. And Nicholas says, when I was younger, I felt God called me to the ministry, but I didn't run after it right away. I thought I needed a real college education first, yet couldn't help feeling I was running from God's voice. Now, years later, I finally feel ready to move forward with my calling, only it feels like I'm doing all the work or as if God changed his mind. I don't know if he does, but is this feeling normal for someone in my shoes? I don't want to make the same mistake twice. That's a great question.
Nicholas, I think you missed it, buddy. I think that there's a time in the affairs of men. Shakespeare said there's a tide in the affairs of men. When taken at its flood, leads on to victory. The tide goes and the flood passes, and then you jump in. You remember God told the people of Israel, I want you to go in and possess the land. So they said, okay, we're going to send some spies in to see what's in there. So the spies came back, and they said, oh, there are giants in the land, and we're like bread to them. They'll eat us up. But Joshua and Caleb said, no, God is with us. We can beat them. Let's go in. But the others said no. And so the Israelites said, we can't make it. And so God spoke to them in judgment, and they said, okay, now we'll go in. So they went running into the land, and these giants came after them and beat the daylights out of them because God had lifted his anointing. So in your case, for all the world, it sounds like you've missed that opportunity, and the tide has passed you by. Now, I don't know that, but I do believe that what you're saying, you've tried it, and somehow it doesn't feel right. I think your day in this one is over, but I may be wrong. I don't know you. I don't know all the circumstances, but that's the biblical message on that one.
Interesting. Well, if you have more questions for Pat,
all right.
It's really easy.
All you have to you want to go fight the giants, do it the first time God tells you to get them. Don't wait.
That's right. Do it. That's the one thing I've learned from you. You came out with the Nike slogan before Nike did. Just do it.
Just do it.
I tell you what, there's a real quick, and then I got a quick story. If you ever go to Pat Roberts and you say, I feel like the Lord's saying this, he will not say, wait a while. He'll always say, just do it.
That's
just
it.
Do it.
Just do it.
So you're the just do it man. All right. Well, when the recession hit, Kurt and Rhonda Mann's lifestyle changed radically. The couple went from big spending to drowning in debt almost overnight.
For years, Kurt and Rhonda Mann felt secure in their finances. They owned a profitable apartment complex and had just bought a Mexican restaurant.
I had money to do what I wanted, when I wanted, and I'd go to car shows sometimes with a wad of cash in my pocket and come home with a new car.
Then the economy crashed. They sold the restaurant on a payment plan, but the new owners fell behind on their payments. The apartment complex was also failing. Relying heavily on credit cards to keep them afloat, they racked up a $150,000 debt.
It was a feeling of just drowning, just absolutely drowning, and a lot of anger going around, a lot of sadness for Kurt because he felt like a failure.
They put their apartment building up for sale, but no one was interested. They couldn't pay their home mortgage and thought they might lose everything, including their marriage.
I was afraid for our relationship, that we might not be able to put these pieces back together again.
That's when Kurt and Rhonda started watching the 700 Club and learned about the importance of giving the first 10% of their income to God. At first, Rhonda wasn't too thrilled about the idea.
If I couldn't put food on my table, if I couldn't put gas in the car, if we couldn't live day to day, then why should we be tithing?
I just knew that I should be doing that because he's provided the money in the first place.
After seeing how much Operation Blessing and Orphan's Promise helped people, they decided to give to the 700 Club. They also sold some of the things they used to consider their prized possessions.
I sold a couple of hot rods. I sold lift out of my shop and a bunch of other equipment. We sold my wife's car just to try to keep going.
We were really tithing at this time. We were just really praying. We were really believing. And the apartment complex sold.
They also got good news when they called their creditors.
Every single creditor, credit card company, made some sort of a deal with us where we were able to get the cards where we could afford them, and they wrote a great deal of them off, too.
But they were still struggling to pay off their mortgage. A CBN representative prayed with them for their finances. The next day, Kurt got a letter from the mortgage company.
He came in and he stood there and he just sobbed. And I said, what's wrong? I thought something horrible had happened. And he said, I want you to look at this. And he said, I want you to read it. I don't know if I'm understanding it correctly. So I looked at it and it said, the review of your financial situation, we have forgiven your second mortgage of $107,000. We have forgiven it. And we both just stood there and cried.
He took us by the hand and more than fed us.
Giving to God first and watch what He does. Oh my gosh. And that's all I can say is, oh my gosh, He has done and done and blessed us and given us a freedom and a peace. Unbelievable.
What a story. You know, life as we know it can be so unpredictable, but the one steady is our Lord Jesus Christ. As I was watching that, all I kept thinking about was the scripture, trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. Lean with all your heart, lean not into your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. You know, a lot of times the path that God has for us and His direction is not our direction, but God's way is always perfect. And He directed them to give in the midst of their need. But there's nothing impossible for God. He just wanted to make sure that they were obedient. And it was in that obedience that blessing came. So won't you be a blessing to those as well? To those who are hungry, to those who are needy, to those who are calling out God, you can be an answer to their prayer right now. If you would just pick up the phone and call, join us, won't you? Become a 700 Club partner. For 65 cents a day, $20 a month is all it takes. You can call the number right there, 1-800-759-0700, or always log on to CBN.com. I want to remind you of something really quick as well. Pledge Express, it's automatic bank transfer where the bank does all the work. And when that happens, literally every month, we give you this phenomenal teaching series from both Pat and Gordon called God's Powerful Purpose. You will love it. Every month, you could put this in your car as you drive and hear the mighty word of God and be encouraged. So call in right now, Pat.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Telephones are available. Call in. Well, still ahead, this man dreamed of being a kingpin drug dealer. And he was well on his way.
I thought that was cool to get high and party and sell drugs and make fast money, and my dad gave me the green light to do it. I took pride in the fact that everything I did was illegal.
See how this man, this career criminal, was brought to his knees.
I moved up.
I moved up.
We've moved up.
CBN partners are moving up in order to give more people hope. Partners who increase their existing monthly pledge move up to the next giving level, bringing their compassion to children and adults here and in 36 countries around the world. Thank you, CBN partners, for all you do, because when you move up, thousands of hurting people move up in life as well.
Houston, I've moved up.
There's a story behind everyone who suffers from serious back pain.
Each day is a battle for me.
I'm a prisoner to my pain.
If you've had an MRI for chronic back or neck pain and been told you might need surgery to correct it, Laser Spine Institute offers advanced procedures that mean no open back or neck surgery. Our outpatient surgery is minimally invasive with less than a 1-inch incision. We treat chronic spine conditions like bulging and herniated discs, spinal stenosis, sciatica, and more. And our advanced procedures mean patients are up and walking around within a few hours of surgery. Contact Laser Spine Institute today and take a big step forward for your back. Don't wait. Call right now and recover your life, not spend your life in recovery.
Call 1-855-356-STEP for a free initial consultation and MRI review. Or visit laserspineinstitute.com. That's 1-855-356-STEP.
And welcome back to the 700 Club. Lawmakers in France have voted to legalize gay marriage. The move came after months of heavy debate and protest, as you see here, that flooded the streets of Paris. Opponents of the law say France is not ready to legalize adoption for same-sex couples at this point, and polls indicate the country is divided on that issue. But France becomes the 14th nation to pass a law allowing gay marriage following New Zealand last week. An Iraqi pastor imprisoned for nearly 2 years is free thanks to the efforts of a U.S. ministry and an Oklahoma senator. Abdi Ali Hamza, better known as Pastor Jamal, spent 21 months in prison. Jamal is a Christian who converted from Islam. He was working to spread the gospel in northern Iraq. He worked with U.S.-based World Compassion to distribute food to refugees there. World Compassion's Terry Law met with officials in northern Iraq carrying a letter for Republican Senator James Inhofe requesting Jamal's release. And eventually, President Masoud Barzani of the Kurdish Regional Government granted him amnesty. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com. We'll be back after this. Stay with us.
New Curves Complete makes losing fat easy as 1, 2, 3. 1. The Curves 30-minute circuit, where millions of women supercharge fat loss. 2. New customizable meal plans that show you how to cook in or eat out. And 3. Me, your Curves coach.
Every week, I review your success and plan for more. Get exercise, meal plan, and coaching for $12.95 a week, plus a free $50 gift. Call 1-800-CURVES-30 to schedule your free consultation.
The sun used to make our outdoor deck and patio space so hot and uncomfortable, we couldn't use it.
But then we discovered the Sunsetter Retractable Awning. Our Sunsetter Retractable Awning opens and closes in just 60 seconds. It keeps our patio about 20 degrees cooler.
It provides instant shade and instant protection from the sun's harmful rays.
And our Sunsetter costs under $700.
But now you can get your Sunsetter
for as little as $499.
When you call now to get this special $200 discount certificate and free awning idea kit.
We love our Sunsetter Retractable Awning, and you're going to love yours too.
Sunsetter awnings are assembled in America and guaranteed to last for years. So call now to get this free awning idea kit with DVD, plus your $200 Sunsetter discount certificate.
But this is a limited time offer.
Call now.
Call now for your free awning idea kit with DVD and $200 discount certificate. There's no obligation.
1-800-201-0421.
To listen to our top songs of the week, go to CBN Radio at CBN.com.
Well, when Irene Medley married her husband, George, she had no idea what she was signing up for. Before long, Irene discovered the truth. Nothing about George was on the up and up, not even his name. George had been arrested more than 30 times. He came from a family of career criminals.
Make money, money, make
money, money.
I was raised in a criminal environment. My dad was a criminal. He was always in and out of jail.
Make money, money, make money, money.
The Medley family had no Rhodes Scholars or aspiring doctors and lawyers. They were criminals, born and bred, and proud of it. Young George Medley took his job seriously.
I thought that was cool to get high and to party and sell drugs and make fast money, and my dad gave me the green light to do it. I was even more motivated to sell, to make him happy.
I want the money, he want the money, she want the money, we all want the money.
Greed is what drove me. I thought having plenty of money would be the source of my happiness.
There was criminal activity inside the Medley home as well. George was sexually abused by his father. In his teens, George escaped to the streets.
I made money off the backs of other people's addiction by selling them drugs, and I didn't have any conscience about it.
George's crimes escalated from drug possession and distribution to car and home invasions. Then robbery, assault, forgery, parole violations, and then false impersonation.
I took pride in the fact that everything I did was illegal.
In his early 20s, George fell prey to the same trap he set for others.
Then that's what started driving me, was the drug addiction.
With George addicted to his own merchandise, profits began to dwindle. Paranoia engulfed him. That's when the police outsmarted him. He'd had jail and bail before, but this time his arrest led to the penitentiary. But George says there was no remorse, just resolve to become a better criminal.
I read every book I could get my hands on about criminals, the mafia. I dreamed of being a kingpin drug dealer.
After his release from prison, George met and married Irene under an alias. Several years later, Irene found out the whole truth. She'd married a drug-addicted criminal.
He'd been arrested dozens of times. I mean, probably over 30.
There would be more.
This doesn't count all the aliases I've been arrested under. This doesn't count my juvenile record.
And I bailed him out each time, and I prayed that this time would be different.
Irene was a Christian. She prayed for 12 more years that George would change. For 12 more years, her husband lied, connived, stole, and cheated. He spent days in drug-induced stupors.
I knew he was living in that misery of being addicted, and God gave me mercy toward him. Sometimes he'd turn to me and say, Irene, I don't want to live like this anymore.
When George was in jail and drug profits dried up, 98-pound Irene took their small tow truck and transported junk cars. She traveled all over Denver to food banks.
My budget was like 30 bucks a month for food.
During George's rare moments of lucidity, he did some self-reflection.
I remember having that just empty feeling, thinking, this is my lot in life, a drug dealer. It was a living hell. Looking over your shoulder, always afraid, always paranoid.
Several months later, George was arrested again. This time, he didn't read crime novels in prison.
I had that feeling I couldn't stand to look at myself in the mirror, and I realized that I was the one who had a problem. And somebody left a little track, a Bible track, on the floor of the jail cell. I read it and thought about it.
Then a prison deputy made a bold move.
He says, what your problem is, you've never submitted to God. And I was thinking, are you kidding me? That's all you got to say? And about 3 days later, I was thinking about what he said. I opened the Bible up to Matthew 6:33, never read the Bible before. And then God turned on the TV screen in my mind and started reminding me of all the crooked things that I did. I hurt a lot of people. And then I knew my soul was in jeopardy, and I cried out to God and asked him to forgive me, and he did.
In the barren cell of a maximum security prison, this cold-hearted criminal became a child of God.
He just gave me a brand new life, from just total despair to hope and confidence.
He literally made him new, because his brain was fried. Anybody who was around him could see it.
8 months later, George walked out of prison doors for the last time. Today, 9 years later, the once greedy ex-con runs a multi-million-dollar auto recycling business. But along the way, he turned almost half of one of his warehouses into a church and food pantry. All he wants to do is help others find what he found.
He's definitely provided for us financially to use those resources to help a lot of people and win souls for the kingdom of God. I haven't run into the person yet that was as evil as I was. I was greedy for money. I'd do anything to get it. But God broke that spirit of greed that I had and replaced it with the spirit of generosity. You just trust God. He will never, ever put you to shame by trusting Him. I've never regretted trusting the Lord.
It'd be hard to think of anybody any more evil, any more addicted to evil, to hurting people, to selling products that destroyed them, to making money on the weaknesses of other people. He preyed on those less fortunate, and he himself was hooked on his own product. You couldn't get any further away from God. And it's so easy to say, God should have written him off. God should have written him off. What right is that man to live? You know, but God reached down and said, George, do you understand I died for you? I love you. And that's what he says to you. It doesn't matter what you have done. It doesn't matter how bad it is. Homosexual, pornography, thieving, murder, rape, robbery, lying, cheating. What have you done? God says, I love you and I will restore you if you'll turn over to me. And George Medley turned it over to God. And now God has put him on another course. It's just amazing that he's prospering and being blessed and he's living with a beautiful wife and he has a good life because God Almighty cleaned him up and made him a part of the kingdom of God. Do you want that? Do you want something better? Well, if you do, I want you to pray with me right now. Don't be afraid. Pray these words. Jesus, that's right. Pray down. Pray now. Jesus, I don't want the life of sin. I want a life of righteousness. And right now, I come to you, Lord, and I ask, I humbly ask that you will receive me as your child. Make me part of your kingdom. Make me part of your family. And I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you prayed with me, I want to give you something very quickly. Our time has run out on this program, but we have something called A New Day. I'll give it to you free if you'll just call right now. 1-800-759-0700. Say, I prayed with Pat. I heard the story by George Medley, and I have been born again. Call right now, 1-800-759-0700. Well, tomorrow, we've got NHL player Shane Doan, who's going to tell us the Bible verse behind his all-star success. And today, we leave you with these words from the book of James, chapter 5. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. That's all the time we've got. Thanks so much for being with us. For Lee and Christy and all of us, this is Pat Robertson. And Lord willing, we'll see you tomorrow on another edition of the 700 Club.
My whole neck snapped down and back up and just pain shot from the top of my head all the way down through my spine, down my right leg. I mean, just a hot shooting, burning pain. My neck was so tight that it's like literally I could probably move it about that far and that was it. There was a testimony on and I said, you know, Lord, I need to be healed. And as soon as I said that, Pat came on and he said, I want to pray right now.
You twisted your neck and you could almost feel something popped out on the side of your neck. Just put your hand over there on it. In the name of Jesus, you'll feel heat and you will be completely
healed. And as I turned my neck, I turned it and it just went. God just supernaturally brought it perfectly into alignment, instantaneously. God has healed me. He's no respecter of persons. God has healing for you as well.